Were you very angry?
Oh, absolutely furious. Of course we were. We had plenty to be angry about. We still do.
Kill men now, ask me how. It was a badge that we had mass made for a meeting.
I mean, we were pretty tough and probably quite alarming.
Yes, we were bloody angry. And some of us still are.
William, stop it. Come on.
Sorry.
In the late 70s, politics in Britain became more extreme. As the state moved dramatically to the right, the left began to fragment. The women's movement was already an established political force, but now a group of women splintered away from the mainstream of feminist thinking. They called themselves the revolutionary feminists. Unlike the socialists, who pictured a revolution where the ruling class and the working class would be on opposite sides of the barricades, revolutionary feminists declared war on men. It all began in Leeds.
Men grow bold as they grow old. They all lose their charms in the end. All men are wankers, said Christabel Pankhurst. Women are a girl's best friend.
You have to be enraged. I still have the rage and I still carry the rage. Rage is absolutely fundamental, not anger, it's not strong enough. It has to be rage.
Sheila Jeffries came to Leeds as an academic and was the revolutionary feminist's leading ideologue.
I was in socialist feminist groups in the early 70s, and what concerned me about socialist feminism is it wasn't naming men and looking at the power relationship between men and women. It was all what we used to call women and Ireland, women and this, women and that. So I was very concerned to problematise the role of men. I was in a London socialist feminist group with Sandra McNeill, and we wanted to reorientate the politics so that we could look at what men were doing. And that's where revolutionary feminism came from, really.
It was 1978 at the Birmingham plenary when we stepped up to the microphone and said, men are the enemy. Oh, you can't say men are the enemy. You will split the movement wide. We must stick together with the male left, an analysis they will provide. Make the coffee. Mind the baby. Don't make such a bloody fuss. Your oppression is due to capitalism. It's got nothing to do with us.
Did you feel a sort of generalised animosity towards men at that time?
Certainly, yes. I did feel very, very, very angry with men. And that was partly some of my own experiences. It certainly came out of listening to a lot of other women's experiences and just looking at who was in control in the world, and particularly in terms of violence against women and the way that men used violence against women or its threat to just control women in every area of their lives, really.
It was a very straightforward, uncomplicated feminism, which proclaimed men as the problem. And it was not poverty, it was not class, it was not race.
Did you define women as a class?
Yes, absolutely. Women were the equivalent of the working class and men the ruling class.
Under patriarchy?
Under patriarchy, that's right. So we hoped to abolish the class difference.
We were told by men on the left that ours was a bourgeois cause, that we had to wait until the proper revolution before we could then say that women deserved liberation. We didn't agree with that. We knew that actually what we deserved was freedom from the tyranny of male oppression, and we were going to get it by any means necessary.
heterosexual couple is the basic unit of the political structure of male supremacy.
I don't need that fucking shit!
It is more efficient by far than keeping women in ghettos, camps, or even sheds at the bottom of the garden. Any woman who takes part in a heterosexual couple helps to shore up male supremacy by making its foundations stronger.
In 1979, the revolutionary feminists in Leeds wrote a manifesto, arguing that women would only be free if they stopped having sex with men.
Giving up fucking for a feminist is about taking your politics seriously. Women who are socialists are prepared to give up many things which they might enjoy because they see how these things tie into and support the whole system of economic class oppression which they are fighting. They will resist buying Cape apples because the profits go to South Africa. Obviously, it's more difficult for some feminists to give up penetration, which is so fundamental to the system of oppression which we are fighting.
The revolutionary feminists advocated what they called political lesbianism. This meant becoming a lesbian for political reasons, whether you fancied women or not.
We're heterosexual women who were on our side. But what I could never understand, and I did resent, was them going home to men at night. It just seemed such a contradiction. And often I would get very angry when I would challenge them about this and they would say, well, that's just the way I am, I just don't fancy women. Having no understanding at all of the fact that sexuality is a social construct and that we all make choices depending on the way that we want to live and the world we want to see. Strong, strong. Strong, strong, like an Amazon. I want to run in the Boston Marathon. I want to go, like Alison. The politics of revolutionary feminism were disseminated around the country and permeated the women's movement. The extremism of the revolutionary position was a challenge to many women.
Being a lesbian is not compulsory. You can't say to a woman who's sort of happily married and bringing up children, whatever, you now politically have to leave your husband and children or whatever to... You know, there's a nonsense of that. It's not something that you can ask and demand. That everybody does.
Was there a contradiction or an issue for you that you would go to an all-women's group, a feminist group, and then go home and sleep with the enemy?
A contradiction? No, there wasn't. I was quite clear that I felt okay about that. I really thought about it a lot, gave it a lot of thought, and I thought, no, this is what I've chosen. I've got every right to choose this. I'm quite clear about why I have and why I'm staying with this. And if other women don't like that, then I can't help that. So, no, it didn't cause... I gave it a lot of thought and a lot of time, but it didn't cause me that much difficulty in the end.
Could you tell me what the word lesbian means to you?
Well, it means two women making love to each other.
Yeah. You agree?
Yeah. Definitely.
I know I said at a certain point, in fact, I wrote something at a certain point about how I wasn't going to enter into this lesbian stuff because I was just too bogged down with childcare and I liked my husband too much.
It's a woman that's doing an unnatural sexual act. Or is it with another woman?
A few years later, things changed. I certainly have been introduced, I guess, to the idea of lesbianism, to the possibility of it through being in the women's liberation movement. But it wasn't until I met someone who was completely outside the women's liberation movement that I found myself falling pell-mell into lust, and I was completely overcome with this desire.
I was involved in a blind women's tape magazine, and as a result of reading articles about lesbians, which weren't about pipe smoking, you know, sort of besuited kind of butch people of indeterminate gender like Radcliffe Hall, but were actually ordinary women like me, I began to realise that the feelings I had for women, and one woman in particular, weren't an aberration or a crush, but were actually about being a lesbian. And that was like... That was very important to me. So being a feminist brought me to lesbianism as well.
If it hadn't been for feminism, I'd be married and shipping the woman next door or something. You know, I wouldn't... I very much doubt that I would have had the energy or the creativity to live a lesbian lifestyle.
Oh, God.
immediate response.
Well, a female homosexual, I mean, that's...
And what would that entail? It's...
Well, nothing much. I mean, it's just the sign of the times, isn't it? It doesn't mean anything to me.
My main experience of it was that it was a bit of a pain because there were all these women who suddenly wanted to be lesbians. They didn't actually terribly want to sleep with women, but they sort of felt they ought to pay their dues. And I don't know what it was about me, but for some reason I was the next best thing to a straight man to be tried out on. And I do actually remember one night a perfectly nice woman with whom I'd had nothing but friendly relations deciding that this was it, she was going to become a proper feminist and go to bed with me. And she, I remember her stroking my breast and saying, "Oh, it doesn't feel strange at all." And I thought, well, this bloody does to me.
I fell in love with a woman, and suddenly a huge crisis for me, because I'd been, you know, for all intents and purposes, heterosexual. Anything other than heterosexuality had not occurred to me. Changed my life in an absolutely radical and revolutionary way, and it was wonderful, quite traumatic. And I have to say that it wasn't desperately easy for my husband at the time either.
We really believed at the time that the vast majority of women would eventually withdraw their energies from men. And then we'd be at the position where men would want to respond against that, and that could create a dangerous situation where there would be barricades between women and men. When men became really angry and realised what was happening, we thought that they might be violent to us and that we would need to defend ourselves. We did have discussions about what to do in those situations. I don't think any of us really thought guns were the answer. I really can't remember that, thinking that. When we went on marches and things, we used to take things like those little sort of plastic lemons with a cap on it. And if men were going to be violent to us, we thought we would squirt them. We had sort of self-defence devices, but not actual weapons.
It would be the combined ranks of the army and the police force versus...
The squeezy lemon! That's right.
Pending the armed struggle, the revolutionaries, along with all good feminists, challenged received notions about how women should look. They wanted to be free from the oppression of making themselves sexually attractive to men.
We rejected makeup, we rejected hair colouring, we rejected the kind of clothing that would make us look as if we were sexual objects, and we wore clothes that were more practical than feminine.
I guess we epitomised the sensible footwear brigade, you know, wing of the feminist movement. We felt that high heels were unnecessary.
I thought it was really important to wear shoes that were comfortable, that were practical, that I could run in, that I could run away from people if I needed to. High heels are thoroughly uncomfortable. They're very bad for you in the long term. They give you spinal injuries. They distort the muscles of your legs, which then goes up to your spine. They're bad for your feet. They give you corns. There is nothing good about wearing high-heeled shoes. If they were so great, men would wear them.
I just thought, great, I haven't got to wear these bloody stupid shoes. That was a real liberation for me, sensible shoes. And it was just to be able to move properly.
It wasn't just shoes, it was bras, it was...
Boots. You could wear boots and a dress. It freed us up, it enabled us to do a lot more things.
You had to conform to a certain way of looking. There were certain behaviours. There were, I mean, no makeup. Oh, heavens, no makeup, the very idea. Women took great pride in not shaving various bits. And those that did have to shave because, you know, they were too hairy to do that, it had to hide the